My name is Elaine Didier, and it's my privilege to serve as the director of the library here in Ann Arbor and also the museum in Grand Rapids. As usual, tonight's program is brought to you with the support of the National Archives, which is our parent organization, but with very, very important support from the Ford Presidential Foundation. So for those of you who are contributors to the foundation and members of Friends of Ford, we thank you because it is your contributions that make this program possible. And now to tonight's program. It is a real pleasure for us to host Kate Anderson Brower, who is the author of not one, but two back-to-back New York Times best-selling books published in 2015 and 2016, respectively. You don't see that very often. Tonight she'll be talking about The Residence, which is inside the private world of the White House, and her prior book was First Women, The Grace and Power of America's Modern First Ladies. In The Residence, Brower explores the lives of some of the people who surround the President of the United States in the White House. No one understands the President nor the President's family, as well as those who work in the White House, and there are generation upon generation of families who are very proud to work in the White House and have had their ancestors do the same. She will be speaking in their voices, their stories, sometimes wry, sometimes affectionist, always gracious, and very proud of their work in the White House and their place of work and their place in our history. In her prior book, First Women, she shares stories ranging from the heartwarming to the shocking and tragic, exploring everything from the First Lady's respective political crusades on behalf of the President to their public and private relationships with their husbands in the past, of course, and to the rivalries and sometimes remarkable friendships that develop in the post-presidential period. Wonderful stories. We are pleased to have copies of both of her books for sale this evening, so if you haven't had a chance to take a look at them, be sure to act quickly after the program. In her role as a journalist, Kate Anderson Brower spent 4 years covering the Obama White House for Bloomberg News and is a former CBS News staffer and a Fox News producer. Her writing and commentary have been featured in a number of publications, including the New York Times, The Washington Post, Vanity Fair, and Bloomberg Businessweek, as well as Time. She recently signed on with CNN as a contributor and has been very busy with speaking engagements over the first half of this year. She recently spoke at a couple of our sister libraries, the George H.W. Bush Library in Texas and the Truman Library, so it's far too long since she's been here at the Ford, the best of them all. So please welcome Kate Anderson Brower to the Ford Library.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Elaine. This has been a fun day, my first time here in Ann Arbor, so go blue, I feel like to say. I went and got a t-shirt this afternoon. And I also want to thank Elaine and also Kate Murray, who arranged the program, and John O'Connell, who has been a very helpful, wonderful researcher to me here as I've gone about researching both of these books. I actually, just last week, I spoke with Dick Cheney for a new project that I'm working on, and I thought it was very apropos to tonight because he offhand told me a story that I love and I have in one of my books about Betty Ford, and he said he fondly remembers approaching President Ford along with Donald Rumsfeld and going into the Oval Office. This was during the presidential campaign, and just very sort of meekly suggesting that someone tell Betty Ford to stop being so vocal about her support for the Equal Rights Amendment. And President Ford just looked at him and said, "Boys, you know where her office is," pointed to the East Wing, "you go tell her yourself." Which he did not. So I have always loved Betty Ford for that and so many other things. And when people ask me who my favorite First Lady is, I always say Betty Ford because of what she did after she left the White House with the Betty Ford Center, and then also what she did to really make breast cancer something people spoke about, and just her honesty and candor. I really admire her, so thank you for inviting me here. I came up with the idea for the residents when I was a reporter at Bloomberg News, and I had a lunch with Michelle Obama and about a dozen other White House reporters, most of us women, who covered the East Wing. And at this lunch, a butler came in and out of the room, dressed in a tux, and Mrs. Obama called him by his first name. And it made me wonder, who are these people who none of us as reporters ever got to actually see? So I went about trying to meet as many of them as I could, and really pull back the curtain, what goes on in the White House. And really, it is a kind of Downton Abbey. There are two basement levels in the White House where the staff would meet and have dinner in the basement mezzanine, they called it, and there was a separate kitchen for the staff, a separate cook for the staff. Many of the staff were African American, and in this picture you see, this is from 1976, from President Ford's time at the White House actually, and this is a gathering of butlers, and on the far left there is Eugene Allen, and the movie The Butler was loosely based on his life. I interviewed Eugene's son, because Eugene has since passed away, and his son told me that the movie isn't that accurate, although it's a wonderful movie, I think, because he said, you know, my parents were actually just pretty boring people. And so they really had to jazz it up and make his mother an alcoholic and kind of add to some of the drama. This is one of the ushers who I got to know, Nelson Pierce. He worked from 1961 to 1987 in the White House, and I think it's really important to note that a lot of these butlers worked there for 30, 40 years, one administration to the next. With the Trump administration now, you have the same butlers there. I have been looking into this, trying to find out if anyone's left, and nobody has. The chief usher is still there. And even if you disagree with the politics of a president, and some of them certainly agree with President Trump, but every administration brings in a new president, and whether he's a Democrat or a Republican, and they all stay. Very rarely does staff ever leave. And I think that says a lot. There are about 96 full-time staff, and these are painters, ushers, maids, butlers. And it's the six or so butlers who work on the second floor and the third floor of the White House who have the most interesting stories, because they get to see the first family as they really live. This is a photo of Jackie Kennedy and John Kennedy Jr. And to her right is Preston Bruce. And he was a very close friend of the Kennedy family. He was a doorman. Her relationship with him was so close that when Jackie and Bobby Kennedy came back from Dallas, and they had been to Bethesda Naval Hospital for the autopsy for President Kennedy, they came back with the body. It was, I think, 4 a.m., and she went into the elevator and broke down crying with Preston Bruce and Bobby Kennedy, and they wrapped their arms around each other. And really, in the elevator of the White House is the only place where they can really be alone and feel like they can really let down their guard. And I think the relationship between Mrs. Kennedy and Preston Bruce is a really touching one. This is her last day in the White House. She was moving out. This is Linwood Westray, who was a wonderful butler, who actually, with a bunch of his friends, got together. He worked from 1962 to 1994. Got together and formed a butlers association in Washington, D.C., and they would go and work at dinner parties in Georgetown. And he said it was great because they got extra money on the side, and every Georgetown hostess wanted to say, here's, you know, this butler serving you is actually a White House butler, to introduce and impress all of their friends. This is one of my all-time favorite stories. It's Mary Prince and Amy Carter on the South Lawn of the White House. And Mary Prince, I actually just spoke with her last week, and I interviewed her for my book. She was Amy Carter's nanny, and she had actually been convicted of murder in Georgia And the Carters had this work release program where they had inmates working at the mansion, at the governor's mansion. And Mrs. Carter just fell in love with Mary, interviewed her, and she and Amy clicked. And Mrs. Carter, who I interviewed, Rosalind Carter, said she knew that Mary never, she didn't believe she killed anyone, and that it was an unfair trial. She wasn't represented well. And so they brought her to live with them at the White House. They got her verdict overturned. And for a period of time, President Carter was her parole officer at the White House. It's very hard to believe this happened. This is George H.W. Bush playing with Lindsay Little, who was a houseman at the White House. And one of the fun parts of my book was finding out the different jobs that these staffers do. And a houseman is really one of the male housekeepers who works in the residence, who lifts the heavy furniture so that the maids can vacuum and sweep around it. And he had this shirt made up that said Houseman's Pride, and he would actually play two or three times a week with George H.W. Bush and President Bush's son Marvin. And it was the highlight of their relationship. And every staffer I interviewed said their all-time favorite president and first lady was President Bush and Barbara Bush. And that's mostly because a lot of these people had not worked for the Fords, who were still alive, who I was interviewing, to be fair. Barbara Bush was just a lovely woman. She's a very dry sense of humor and could be very difficult, but they all said that she really took an interest in their lives. Here she is at in the flower shop of the White House. It's in one of the basement rooms. It's a windowless little cubby, and she's checking out one of the decorations. She would come in the early morning, every single morning, rain or shine, in her bathrobe with her bathing suit underneath it to go take a swim in the White House pool, which President Ford had built, so that's a Ford connection there. The outdoor swimming pool. This is the Clintons on their last day in the White House. And I'm sure we all would have loved to see the Obamas saying goodbye in the Trump transition, because I think what happens on that day is so interesting. The staff gathers with the outgoing president, first lady, and family, and they say goodbye. And it's so emotional that there's usually not a dry eye in the room. This happens in the morning, usually very early, between 7:30 and 8 a.m. And I was told that with the Bushes, President Bush 41 was so overcome with emotion that Barbara Bush had to step in and actually say goodbye for him. Because for the family, it's the staff who become their family. They're the only people who don't want anything from them, and it just becomes a very close relationship. Here's President Bush, George W. Bush, with James Ramsey, who was one of the butlers who I interviewed, who I really enjoyed talking to. And here is, and this is a little bit far away, but this is one of those, this is a photo that was given to me. A couple of these were given to me by staffers, so they're not publicly available. And this is part of that ceremony where they are standing in the East Room, and it is Stephen Roshan saying goodbye. He is the chief usher of the White House, who runs the White House, essentially, saying goodbye to President Bush and his family and presenting them with the flag that flew over the White House the day they were inaugurated and the flag that flew the last full day they were in office. And that's one of those things that they do every 4 to 8 years. It's part of the ceremony, and you see the chefs are gathered there, you've got the maids, you've got engineers, you have about 100 or so full-time staffers there saying goodbye. This is Admiral Roshan, who was a wonderful source of mine, but also a wonderful man. He was an admiral in the Coast Guard, and he was the chief usher during Bush 43 and President Obama. And there he is escorting President Obama to the Oval Office, which he did every morning. And I asked him what kind of things would come up, and he said, sometimes things like as simple as, you know, the hot water isn't running right today, or the Wi-Fi is slow. It could be anything. They're just kind of making small talk, really. And here's Michelle Obama saying, I'm not sure what she's just saying hello to George Haney, who is one of the reason why I picked this photo is because George is one of the full-time butlers on the second floor. And he was the hardest interview to get I've ever had. And I went to his house eventually. He talked to me from my second book, wouldn't talk to me from my first book. And he told me a great story about how Marion Robinson, Michelle Obama's mother, you know, she lived in a suite on the third floor, and she would get so lonely that he felt badly for her, that she was cooped up in the White House. So his wife occasionally took her to a suburban shopping mall for lunch, and they just hung out together and became friends. And I thought that was really kind of sweet. And so this is my book about first ladies. I sort of was working on both books at the same time because a lot of the stories from the resident staff had to do with the first lady. And when a decision comes from the second floor, that means it's coming from the first lady. And it's the resident staff who works with the first lady and their social secretary to figure out what food they're going to eat for the week, to figure out who sits next to who at state dinners. It's a really personal relationship. One thing I want to point out about the transitions between families, and because this is about the Fords, I thought this one really quick passage from the residence made sense to read. The Nixons' formal style was replaced by the more relaxed attitude of Gerald and Betty Ford, who allowed their four children to wear jeans in the White House. Susan Ford even roller skated on the state floor's pristine floors while her parents were traveling, which she told me she was embarrassed she had done now. Betty Ford was fiercely independent, and when she got the tour of the second floor family quarters, she immediately rejected the idea of sleeping in a separate bedroom from her husband. There'll be no need for that, she told the head usher. She could not understand why the maids and butlers were so quiet around her. She worried that they didn't like her. She soon found out that Pat Nixon had preferred it that way. Pat Nixon was lovely, but she was just much more shy. Carpenter Milton Frame was impressed by Betty Ford's approachable manner. I do recall that Mrs. Ford would invite you to sit down and have a cup of tea, he said fondly. They made small talk, and she asked him where he was from, an act of kindness that her predecessor would not have initiated. Betty always enjoyed teasing the staff. During a tour of the private quarters, her press secretary, Sheila Rabb Weidenfeld, noticed a flower vase featuring the figures of two angels with their hands almost touching. A cigarette was perched in one of the angel's hands. Oh, that, the first lady said, laughing. I put it there. That's just my way of testing whether the maids have cleaned the room. So that's another reason why we love Betty Ford, right? Here's a photo of Lady Bird Johnson, Betty Ford, Rosalind Carter, Nancy Reagan, Barbara Bush, and Hillary Clinton. And what I wanted to do was kind of get a sense of how close they are and whether they keep in touch. Is there a President's Club in the same way as there's, you know, a First Lady's Club? And I found out that there really is, but it has nothing to do with politics. It has to do with their personalities. So Betty Ford was very close with Barbara Bush and Rosalind Carter. If you look at the letters between them, it really does reveal this very close relationship that endured long after they left the White House. Here, I love this photo because it shows Pat Nixon, Mamie Eisenhower, Lady Bird Johnson, and Jackie Kennedy, and this is on President Kennedy's inauguration on the Capitol steps. And these women had known each other for decades. Pat Nixon's husband had served with JFK and Johnson in Congress. And I think they're just such completely different people. And that's really what I wanted to explore. And the letters between Jackie Kennedy and Pat Nixon are some of the best because Jackie Kennedy had a really complicated relationship with Pat Nixon because their husbands had been rivals in 1960. And when Nixon finally won in 1968, Jackie wrote Pat Nixon this great letter that basically says, I hope you're happy now, kind of thing. It's a very tough letter. Here is Jackie. I get into the book a little bit about how much, you know, how protective she was of her children in the White House. And I like this photo because they're in the residence and it shows her playing with Caroline and John Kennedy Jr. And really kind of the maternal side. She would get really upset when she would see photos of her kids in the press. She wanted to have control. And in fact, the famous photo of John Kennedy Jr. poking his head out of the Resolute desk was taken when Jackie Kennedy was out of town. And when she came back, all hell broke loose. Because JFK understood the power of those photos and really took advantage of them. This is a photo of Betty Ford showing the Johnsons the presidential living room. The Johnsons were coming back for a tour of the White House after they had left. And the reason why I picked this photo is that small black suitcase at the foot of the bed is Betty Ford's suitcase. That night she was going to the hospital to have a mastectomy. And she never told Lady Bird Johnson because she said she didn't want to ruin her visit. And I just thought that was an incredible thing. And then I remember interviewing Ron Nesson, their press secretary, and he described how insistent Betty Ford was that in the press release, it says that she was having breast cancer surgery because the original press release said something like women problems, that she was dealing with women problems. Because at the time, people didn't talk about breast cancer. And so I thought that was a really powerful image. This is a great photo of Betty Ford and David Hume Kennerly, who I'm sure has been here, told me the story about how he took this photo on President Ford's last full day in office. And Betty Ford said something like, well, I always wanted a seat at the cabinet table, and jumped up. And I just love this photo. It says a lot about her. And apparently, President Ford didn't see it. For years, she was embarrassed about it. And David Kennerly said that when he showed it to the President Ford, he about fell off his chair. It was so disrespectful. But he loved it and had a laugh about it. And she was a Martha Graham dancer, so there she is. Rosalynn Carter and Jimmy Carter, I thought, really fascinating relationship. She had this weekly lunch with him, and here she is, and I like how she's kind of leaning in and he's leaning in. He got so tired of her coming up to him with a stack of papers every night with a list of things she wanted to talk to him about, and he just wanted to relax. He said, well, why don't you come with your binder and we'll talk at lunch? So once a week they had this lunch, and I think, you know, she was a really kind of, preceding Hillary Clinton, was one of the most involved first ladies we've ever had. She was an integral part of the Camp David peace accords, kind of helping with diplomacy. She was out during the Iran hostage crisis campaigning for him when he couldn't leave Washington. And so I really enjoyed talking to her and learning more about her role as first lady. It's a great photo of Lady Bird Johnson and Barbara Bush, who were lifelong friends, stayed friends till Lady Bird's death, actually. One of the stories from the residence that I like best is about Lady Bird and how she calmed Lyndon Johnson down. And one of Johnson's advisors told me that he was essentially a manic depressive. He was kind of all over the place and could be very difficult. And he pointed to this example of Johnson's obsession with the White House shower. And he became absolutely obsessed with it. And so he pretty much drove one of the, White House staffers nuts. The White House plumber, Reds Arrington, actually had a nervous breakdown and was hospitalized over the shower, of all things. So, this is just a really quick thing. The Kennedys never complained about the shower, so the engineers were at a loss. A team was sent to the Elms to study the plumbing. That was the Johnsons' home in Washington, D.C. And Reds Arrington, the plumber, was even sent to the Johnsons' ranch near Stonewall, Texas, nicknamed the Texas White House, to increase the water pressure and heat there to nearly scalding temperatures. When he found out that a new shower for the president would require laying new pipe and putting in a new pump, Johnson demanded that the military pay for it. The project, which cost tens of thousands of dollars, was paid for with classified funds that were supposed to be earmarked for security. We ended up with four pumps, and then we had to increase the size of our water lines because the other parts of the house were being sucked dry. And one of the things that Red's widow told me, she said she remembered hearing President Johnson on the line screaming at her husband, saying, "If I can move 10,000 troops in a day, you can certainly fix the bathroom any way I want it." And I interviewed President Johnson's daughter, Lucy, who told me that she said, you know, my father was dealing with Vietnam and had all of these pressures, and the least he could have was a nice hot shower. So she wasn't apologetic about it. Richard Nixon came in, took one look at the elaborate setup, and said, "Get rid of this stuff." So it was all for nothing. But I always liked that story because I think it shows a side of, you know, the Johnson White House that you don't always get to see. President Johnson was also obsessed with turning the lights off, and he would wander around the basement and make sure no one was working late at night with the lights on. And one time he happened upon, it was a carpenter who was just working late, and he saw the lights were on, and he was screaming and yelling, and he didn't realize anyone was there, and the carpenter came out and just said, "I'm still here, I'm working." And so he went away and kind of embarrassed, but he was obsessed with saving money on electricity and obsessed with the water temperature and how intense it was. Here's Rosalind Carter, Lady Bird Johnson, and Betty Ford. They're just relaxing at the Johnson's house in Texas. And I thought this was a great photo because a tour bus drove by. And apparently people were just so excited to see that all the flash bulbs went off in the tour bus. People were really excited to see three former first ladies. You would never expect to see relaxing together. And they did spend time together, and I think there really was a real friendship there. This is dark here, but it's not a great, it's not an easy photo to see, but there's Hillary Clinton in the blue room of the White House doing her makeup at a mirror, and there's James Jeffries, who was a butler at the White House. And I interviewed James, and he described how, you know, you're like a fly on the wall. You don't want anyone to know that you're there. And I just thought it was an interesting photo because she's getting ready for this black tie event. It was the governor's dinner, and he's kind of got his back sort of turned. There's some things in the book about the Lewinsky scandal in terms of how that affected Hillary Clinton and the staff in the White House, and how they felt, some of the women on the staff felt incredibly, you know, torn and sorry for her, and especially a certain point where she had President Clinton sleeping on a sofa in an adjoining room because she was so mad at him. And I think that a lot of the staff felt that he kind of deserved that at that moment. So it was hard for the staff, and the butlers, I was told the butlers knew about what was going on a long time before it ever became public. So I think it was a hard time for them because of the respect they have for the office. And so it was a difficult time to work at the White House. This is Melania Trump, obviously, and Donald Trump. I think we're still kind of waiting to see how she defines the role of First Lady. She has about four or five staffers now working for her, compared to Michelle Obama's 24, so much smaller staff. On a personal note, as someone who has worked with trying to get interviews and reporting on East Wing staff, it's always really difficult because the people around the First Lady are always very protective. But this staff is particularly, I think, protective, but also there just aren't enough people right now, and it's taking them a little bit of time to get settled. Here is a photo. I like this photo because I think it says a lot. You've got Nancy Reagan, who sometimes felt a bit like an outsider. Her first priority was always her husband. Lady Bird Johnson and Hillary Clinton chatting, they became friends. And then you have Betty Ford, Rosalind Carter, and Barbara Bush, who as you saw with the photo of them on that front porch, they really were friends. I do think one story that I didn't get to tell, it's a short one, is just that that I thought was really interesting and I didn't know about it before, was that Jackie Kennedy did not come back to the White House until after her husband's assassination, until Pat Nixon invited her for her official portrait unveiling. And it's an incredible story because it was so painful for Jackie Kennedy, such mixed feelings. And so there are these wonderful letters where, you know, they're trying to convince Jackie Kennedy to come back to the White House, and she says, okay, as long as no one in the press finds out. And apparently Helen Thomas somehow found out. She's a great reporter. And she said she wouldn't tell anybody if she got an exclusive interview with Pat Nixon. And so it's just a really interesting scene of Jackie Kennedy and her two children coming into the White House that they had these really fond memories of, and what that was like, and having dinner with the Nixons. And I think it's surprising that, you know, Pat Nixon and Jackie had that bond. And then there's a beautiful letter that Jackie wrote to Pat Nixon where she said, can you imagine that the day that I dreaded most was one of the most wonderful days I've ever spent with my children? And I just think it says a lot about how these relationships have nothing to do with politics and everything to do with just human beings feeling for each other. And so I really, you know, have so much respect for these women and also for the staff who I've gotten to know, and definitely for the Fords. So thank you very much for coming. It's wonderful to speak here, and I really appreciate it. Thank you. If you have any questions, I would love to take any questions about either book or. Or you can just shout one, or you can just raise your hand and I'll repeat it. About could be anything. Yes.
Did the staff have to sign any kind of confidentiality oath?
They didn't in 2015. Yeah, did the staff have to sign a confidentiality oath or a non-disclosure agreement? No. They didn't when I was working on the book, which was from 2012 to 2015. No. I've since heard that they were, the chief usher was not so happy with some of the staff talking to a reporter, and so that may have changed since then. Because they're very protective, and I think I understand why, and you can understand why. This is the only place the first family can really be private. But I did mean the book to be more of a celebration of the work of these people who don't get paid a lot and don't get a lot of attention. It's not really a tell-all, although there are some like little things in there, I hope, that are interesting. Does anyone have any other questions about, yes? No, you go ahead first and then I'll
I was wondering, sorry. You mentioned that Michelle Obama had so many staff, Melania and Trump so few. Is that because Melania is not at the White House?
She was saying, why did Michelle Obama have so many staffers and Melania Trump so few? I think it is because of different interpretations of the job. I mean, Michelle Obama didn't want to move to Washington either with her two young daughters, but was told she had to. And I think Melania Trump, you know, was really putting her foot down, saying she wasn't going to move. And now we see that I've been told, and it's been out there, that she is going to move this summer. And I think we're going to start seeing a change where we see more of Melania Trump. Now she is a communications director. I also think that people feel that 24 is too much. When I've said that to people, they sometimes think, well, that's ridiculous. But I think it should depend on what the First Lady's agenda is. And Michelle Obama's Let's Move agenda was pretty aggressive. And, you know, some of the work she did was very, you know, tackling some big topics, just in the same way that some of the work, other First Ladies have done, like Nancy Reagan with the Just Say No campaign and things like that. So I think it depends on what they want to do. I do know that Melania Trump, I've been told, feels a lot of pressure coming on the heels of Michelle Obama, and that she feels pressure to come up with an idea like Let's Move, the campaign to end childhood obesity that Michelle Obama had, to do something that kind of matches that. And I think it's a tremendous amount of pressure for somebody to be under. So, you know, I think a lot of people want to like the First Lady, regardless of if they're a Republican or a Democrat. And I think she's kind of trying to find her voice, and it could take a while. It took Michelle Obama almost a year to announce the Let's Move campaign. So I think that people are going to give her some time, I think. Yes?
Were any of the Butlers former Pullman car porters?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. I didn't ask. I guess I should have asked that question. I'm sorry. it's a good question. He said, were any of the Butlers former Pullman car operators? Or porters, sorry. I don't know. Do you think you know anyone that works there?
No, but certainly they would get the training.
Yeah. No, that's a good question. I don't know. Yes?
You mentioned that they weren't paid very well. What were they paid?
So she's saying you mentioned they weren't paid very well. What were they paid? They were paid, you know, it's interesting, they're government employees, but the bad part is they're government employees who can be fired for any reason at any time. So unlike other government employees, some of whom have, you know, situations where it's harder to fire them, they're really working at the pleasure of the president. And so there have been maids who've been fired because they couldn't take the pressure of, you know, being up in the bedroom while the First Lady is walking in the room or there's a discussion. It takes a really special kind of person to do this job, who doesn't tell secrets, who has a lot of discretion, and who also can handle being around these like hugely famous people all the time. But I think the starting salary was in like the 30s. $30,000 a year, depending on what the staff was. Now, if you had like the executive chef, the executive pastry chef was making about $100,000. I mean, they were, you know, it was really a very big range. Nobody there is making more than, say, I think the chief, I don't know, the chief usher is the top person, like the general manager. And I want to say maybe $150,000 or something like that. In the private sector, you know, I interviewed the chief pastry chef, who said he was getting offers to work in the Ritz at Paris, you know, for $600,000 a year, because they wanted to say they had a White House chef working there. So, but he said, you know, I said, why didn't you take it? And he said, you don't understand, this job is my life. And he described after 9/11, I have some of it in the book, having panic attacks in the shower. I mean, they really felt 9/11 was such a traumatic time for the staff, because they felt that the planes were coming for, you know, and no one knew. Yeah, and they could have been. So they were really working in the bullseye. And there's a story about the chief usher at the time and a couple other staffers staying, moving picnic tables off the South Lawn that day, and, you know, potentially risking their lives. And they moved these heavy picnic tables so that Marine One could land, because President Bush was coming back on his helicopter. But I thought that was a story that really shows their devotion, because at the time they really didn't know what would happen. So, but they could definitely have made more in the private sector.
To follow
yes.
up on that, do the staff
No. They don't live there. They used to. I mean, back in, like, you know, the Roosevelt era, you know. And if there's a snowstorm or something like that and there's an event, sometimes the staff will sleep there. The pastry chef had, like, a little bed that he had in his office. But it was rare. Most of them would, you know, live in the suburbs, wake up at the crack of dawn, come in at, you know, 6 or 7 in the morning. Their hours are really, really long.
So their salaries really aren't supplemented by
the... No, but they do get overtime. So working, like, you know, if a butler stays late to work at a state dinner, they get paid, you know, time and a half for that extra time. So sometimes they don't mind staying late because they do make more. But it's really not about, I mean, it sounds cheesy to say it, but I believe it, is that it's not about the money for them. It's about saying that they work for the presidency, and they serve, they have so much respect for the institution, no matter who is there.
And is there Secret Service presence in the White House 24/7?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, is there Secret Service protection in the White House 24/7? Like inside? Yes. Of course, unfortunately, we've seen some cases recently where people have jumped the fence and all sorts of things like that. That is terrible. And actually, Michelle Obama found out about the bullet that came through the window of the Truman balcony that was discovered by a White House maid. This was a few years ago. A White House. So when that happened, I asked Stephen Roshan, who was the chief usher, I said, is this like shocking to you that a maid would find this? And he told me, when I would interview people for a job as a maid, it was also, I want you to look around, and if you see anything that looks weird, you have to let us know. And so keep your eye out for things that are unusual, people you don't recognize. And I mean, she actually found a bullet. So things like that happen. It's like if you're a maid at the White House, you're also a private eye or something. It's crazy. But yes, there is Secret Service. They don't have many places where they're really alone, but they have on the second floor, the Secret Service are kind of moved. You know, there is this place where the Carters actually were really upset and had the agents moved closer to the elevator and the staircase so that they weren't kind of visible and always there. So really in the residence on the second and third floors of the White House, whereas the West Sitting Hall, the living room, they're not Secret Service like hanging out right there. They're kind of, you know, they're not like standing in the pantry. There are butlers standing there though who will wait for a bell to ring to get whatever the president and first lady want to drink at any moment, which I think sounds great, but. Any other questions? Yes?
How do you get a job there?
You want one? Yeah, no. He asked, how do you get a job there? I mean, it's a great question. You get a job through people. That's why so many of these people are related to each other. You know, so many of the people, 9 members of one family worked at the White House. And I interviewed one of them for the book, and it's amazing. I mean, his uncle worked there, his grandfather worked there. I mean, it just goes, it's like a proud tradition because they're not advertised in newspapers. You need to trust the people. You need to make sure that no one has a criminal record. I mean, they always talked about not even wanting to get a DUI. Anything like that would ruin your chances of working there. So they're all very, very careful about speeding tickets and things like that. So they have very clean records. And the FBI, they do these full field investigations where they go and interview, you know, their kindergarten teacher. I mean, they go way back. And it takes almost a year for some of them to get clearance. So it's a very long process to work there. Anybody else? Yes.
Well, I'm just wondering, with the new administration, our new president has some very different ideas. Has he brought his staff from some of his places that he's lived, and what do you foresee might be some differences?
That's also a great question. I would love to know the answer to. I've been trying to find out what's going on there now in terms of what the staff. I will say I think the staff is more worried now than ever before about talking. And I think that has to do with the fact that it's a transition, so they don't know what to expect. But it's always the resident staff. I was just told today by a staffer I know who works in the residence, she said, it's always the resident staff the finger is going to somehow get pointed to us, so I don't want to say anything about this. Because there was a rumor that I heard actually this morning about how someone was saying that President Trump sometimes gets food delivered from New York, like meals delivered from New York. Yeah, well, and I don't know, not that. And I just thought that was curious, so I went and I asked somebody at the resident staff, and they said that's not true, he loves our cooking, you know, so they're very defensive about that. And then I said, well, will you say that, and can I, you know, confirm that and say what foods he likes? We know he likes Lay's potato chips and things like very simple things. And she wouldn't confirm it. So, I mean, because I think they're just really afraid. You never know with any new administration. It doesn't matter who it is. They could get fired for any reason. So they're, you know, always worried. I don't think he's brought, and as to my knowledge, I don't think he's brought anyone with him. And the only things I've heard is that he's fine with the staff. I have not heard anything yet, but I mean, these things take time. You know, people don't talk until they retire, usually. No. No, absolutely not. It would be interesting if they did. Yes.
How does the cooking staff prevent the president from being poisoned? Is there like a special group of people who are the cooks? Or do the cooks have to eat the food first?
Yeah. It's a great point. There is actually, so he's asking how does the staff prevent the president from being poisoned? And there is a head of the storeroom, his name was Bill Hamilton, he recently retired, and he would go in an unmarked Secret Service van to, he would never tell me where, but it was a local Safeway or Giant, he wouldn't say which one, and he would go and just buy whatever kind of things they needed, like bananas or apples. If someone needs milk, he's the one who goes and gets it for the residents. And no one would ever suspect, he's just a normal looking guy, so they just send a guy in plain clothes to go and buy their food. In terms of what they eat, if they go out, I've been told that they do have somebody taste their food, but I'm not sure about if they, one of the chefs told me that he thought his job was the most important job in the White House for that very reason. And they, after 9/11, changed some of the security, but he wouldn't tell me exactly what, because they're afraid to kind of get that stuff out there. But he says it's much, after 9/11, things have gotten much more strict in terms of food security at the White House. But I always thought it was interesting that this one guy would go in an unmarked van to a regular supermarket and just pick up bushels of bananas or, you know, shampoo or whatever it is for the family, and no one would ever know it. Yes?
Do members of the resident staff serve at Camp David? And secondly, what about at some of the presidents regularly going to their own homes, mm-hmm. Johnson's Ranch, the Western mm-hmm. Ranch, do the White House staffers sit
yeah.
there?
Yeah, sometimes the White House staffers would go with them to, like, Crawford. Bush would bring some of the staff with him to the ranch there. They also have staff that are there regularly, too. There is, Camp David has their own staff, but one of the people that I spoke to for the residents is now she's retired and she's working at Camp David. So there's a lot of, like, there's a lot of crossover there. President Obama, they rarely went to Camp David. And I don't think that the Trumps are going to be going to Camp David that often either. It's kind of a rustic place to go. So I don't know what the Camp David staff does when the family's not there, because they're not there a lot. But, you know, sometimes, like, Barbara Bush brought her personal maid to the White House. Sometimes they do bring their staffs with them. And sometimes they leave. Nancy Reagan, you know, left with a White House maid who she loves so much and brought her back to California with her. So sometimes they kind of poach staff, too, which is interesting. Yes? Yeah. Well, she's asking if there's the same sort of tradition at the Naval Observatory as there is at where the Vice President lives, as there is at the residence. And there is a staff there, much smaller staff, and they're all military. And my understanding is it's like 6 people. I mean, it's a really small staff. It's interesting because I just interviewed Dick Cheney for something, and he brought a staffer that had worked with him at the observatory with him, and he now works for him at his house in Virginia. So it really is like they really do get attached to the staff, and they do bring some of them with them when they leave. The observatory is beautiful, and it's actually a nicer place to live than the White House because it's like a real home. Yes?
Do the first family pay for their own food as in the residence?
So she's saying, do the first family pay for their own food in the residence? And they do. They pay for their own food when, you know, if you have a friend over for coffee, they get the bill for that. And there's actually a funny Gerald Ford story where his daughter, Susan Ford, his daughter, was telling me, you know, she had some friends over, and President Ford said, so I got the bill, you know, I do see those bills. Like, you guys had two hamburgers, three, you know, because he was very penurious and knew. They pay, Rosalind Carter told me when she got a bill for $600 for their first month there, she could not believe it. And $600 in the 70s was actually, you know, she was pretty mad. And so I think people don't realize that they do pay for their own personal food. They're not paying for, like, state dinner food or any formal things, but when they have breakfast or whatever, that's, they're getting charged for that, yeah. So, oh, yep. I am working on a new book. She was asking if I was working on a new book, it has a lot to do with the vice presidency and the kind of relationships between presidents and their vice presidents, and you know, I'm looking into the relationship between President Trump and Mike Pence, and is Mike Pence a very powerful vice president, and what's really going on there, and then, you know, it's just a very difficult, the vice presidency, kind of like being first lady, I think, is one of those really tough jobs, because there's no, you know, there's just no really, nothing written down other than two specific things about being president of the Senate, and then if the president dies, you take over. But their job description is not clear, and so I'm kind of looking into that idea. But, well, thank you so much for everything. It's a great experience. Thank you.
Before you go, we have a commercial coming, but first of all, thank you so much, Kate. This was wonderful. On a rainy night, this is such
thank
a tribute
you.
To you.
Thank you for coming.
And I think that, as I can attest, the books are full of these and many, many more anecdotes, so you'll enjoy them very much. But to sign your books in the lobby, we have pens with the signature of our favorite president, Gerald Ford. So
thank
may you,
you
sign and write future
Aww.
Books in good health.
Thank you,
thank
so,
you
much.
So much.
Thank you so much.
Now, coming up, for those of you who have expressed chagrin that back in December we had to cancel a program about the Shah of Iran, you will be thrilled to know that we have rescheduled that program with Andrew Scott Cooper. This is on the Fall of Heaven, the Pahlavis, and the Final Days of Imperial Iran. That will be on May 16th. I know several of you had already bought the book and read it, and so we really got a lecture that we better get him back. So we listened, and he's coming. And if you're in Grand Rapids, next Monday night, we're having someone from this part of town, Tony England, who is a former astronaut and just happens to be the current dean of the University of Michigan Dearborn College of Engineering. Tony will be speaking for us on Monday night at the museum in conjunction with our space exhibit. Tony is a former astronaut and was involved as a Michigan mission scientist on Space Lab 2. So come on over to Grand Rapids for that. And as you can appreciate, we are already busily scheduling for fall for both of our sites. So we have an exhibit in the lobby if you have not seen it. It's a very special one because it was curated by Mark Clegg, who's a professor of musicology at the music school right down the street. It's about the Star Spangled Banner, and if you missed that program, it's on YouTube. It was simply fabulous. We had a piano on stage, we had pianist and soprano, and an audience sing-along. The Star Spangled Banner has a very interesting history. We all learned a lot, and Mark's exhibit is really wonderful, so please make sure to take a look at his work. We have surveys about the program if you'd like to fill those out. And if you'd like to get on our email list, there are forms out in the lobby as well. So we have a book signing, we have a reception, and stick around and have a chance, because clearly we have only scratched the surface on questions for Kate. So thank you again for coming. Take care.